This is, what is it, 3 weeks before Christmas?
No.
Two?
Two.
Oh, and not ready for even for winter, and it kind of hit us.
Yeah.
this message that I have today is kind of interesting in the sense that I've been dealing with people at work and through my life in noticing that there's a lot more people out there that have chosen not to believe the Bible. And, you know, we worship the Lord and the creator of the universe. And this is like, to me, well, this is a big deal. And the other rest of the people feel that it's, you know, unimportant. It's totally made up religion. And I've talked to many people that feel that way. I'm going to be addressing some of these in here and showing how Jesus is unique and how he is above all these things. And in the end, all these other theories that the world has to kind of debunk the truth of the gospel, you know, don't even compare to what we have. So, one thing that happened in the outline is all of the underlined words. I have a slide that I'm going to have up here, and I'm going to have you help me because my slide, the words are not in it. It was supposed to have been a little joke because this was supposed to be blank as well. And that was my mess up, and I sent that to John, but let's go on with this. So let's think for a moment. What is it about Jesus that makes him so unique among all people, all prophets, religious leaders who've ever lived? I mean, you know, we have the Bible, we have the scriptures, we study and we learn about who Jesus is. We know what the scriptures tell us. A lot of people in the world that say, well, I can't trust the Bible. Give me some other proof. Well, I'm going to try to do that a little bit, but at the same time, I have to use the Bible because it's the most reliable source we have to prove that Jesus is. The Bible is clear on who Jesus is. In Matthew 16, Jesus asked the disciples for the people's opinion. He says to them, who do the people say that I am? And they say, some say you're John the Baptist. Others say you're Elijah, Jeremiah, back, you know, reincarnated type of thing, back from the dead. And but Jesus then asks, well, who do you say that I am? And Peter rises up. He says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Gives me chills. And then Jesus replies to him and says, that was not made known to you by human knowledge. The Holy Spirit, God gave that to you. Now, that's important because that is a foundational thing in all of what I'm going to be sharing. Jesus, and then also Jesus told the disciples not to say that to anyone yet. Time wasn't right. But, I have an opening joke. And John said, oh, he all usually has a joke. And Mary has a smile on her face because I already told my jokes to the girls that they wanted to hear this morning. You may have, this is off the internet, and you may have, you know, come across this. So young Eddie was spending Christmas with his grandparents. On Christmas morning, the family went to church. And while they were waiting to go in, Eddie had checked all the announcements and pictures along the walls. When he came to a group of pictures of men in uniform, he asked a nearby church member, who are all those men in the pictures? The reply was, why, those are our boys who died in the service. Ah, now we know where we're going. Dumbfounded, young Eddie asked, was that the carol service or the Christmas Day service? Because I don't want to be that one. I don't want to go there. hopefully we won't have any of that going on. There are stories about Paul preaching and somebody, you know, falling to their death, but, you know, Paul revives that person, but, you know, interesting. A young child not understanding. I was telling the girls, my girls this morning, it's like, Sometimes we have visitors that come to a church on Christmas or Easter or whatever, and they're unfamiliar with some of the customs that are done and some of the word terminology used. I have another joke later, kind of in the middle of my presentation, that talks about something else than that. But anyhow, we're moving on to, okay, so this is the time of year when Christians reflect on the birth of Jesus and they celebrate the incarnation, God becoming man. This was unprecedented in all of history, making Jesus the most unique historical figure of all time. No historical figure has more impact on the world than Jesus. Now, that's a statement that I'm making here. And when I share that with people at work, they go, blah, bah humbug type of thing. And, you know, I have guys that I've worked with over the years, and I kind of help them understand you need to have faith, you need to be able to believe, and the Holy Spirit gives you that, the ability to believe and to have faith in Jesus. The Bible tells us that the Scripture is discerned spiritually, not through the wisdom of man. We can't comprehend all. We can't understand, totally comprehend all that God has, and to, you know, but certainly there are things that we can't understand. There are things that we can actually grasp onto because there's truth. I'm going to attempt to share some of that today. So the skeptic, the lost, I put in parentheses, because they are. They say it's all nonsense. And to me, that kind of hurts. And I feel like Apostle Paul has spoken about that in his letters, that if Jesus hadn't risen from the grave, then all this is worthless, really. And but Jesus was, or Paul was saying that in a way to that those who he was speaking to actually knew the truth. So here we go. How do we answer the skeptic who says Jesus never existed? How do we come back when somebody tells us that? Or if so, he was just an ordinary man, nothing special, just an itinerant preacher going around. His followers fabricated the story. I've heard this. I've heard all of these. Maybe it's all made up. I'm going to go and share some material that shows that cannot possibly be the case. The Bible is unreliable and plagued with errors, okay? Yes, I've heard that over and over. So now I have to go and share. I'm going to bring in some material that shows that that's not the case either. But when I'm out speaking to someone, or I'm at work and I'm working, and all of a sudden conversation, it's like, What do I say? You know, do you ever get that? We get like, a brain blockage, whatever. It's like, I know the answer, but it's just not there right now. and then, you know, tomorrow it comes, or you're laying in bed and you get the answer. It's like, and then you go back. So remember that conversation we had? I've got an answer for you now. Oh, yeah, now you have an answer. But Then we have here, the resurrection is impossible. No one has ever risen from the dead. And unless you're a Hollywood movie actor who's risen from the... Never mind. But some of these I'm going to share in here. So the purpose. I want to get into covering the uniqueness of Jesus by addressing the concerns of the skeptics as to the issues that they raise surrounding the biblical Jesus. Now, I'm trying to track with what I have printed out here. And where was I at? Okay. Much of what we have to present, what I have to present today, is not original material. This has been researched, not just by me. I put some of it together for this message presentation. But a lot of more knowledgeable theologians, scholars have spent awful amounts of time and research and lifetime studying this material about the uniqueness of Jesus, that the scriptures are reliable, that we can believe what we've been told, and that the writers did not fabricate what they wrote, and that it is all based upon firsthand evidence and witnesses. Some of these men here speak about those things. And Norman Geisler, I got a lot of things from him in here, but I just wanted to put that up there so that we know that we have a little bit of reference. And if anybody wants some more things later, I can let you know some things to look up. And I really probably should have had a slide with some of that as well. Since we are recording it for the internet, that might have been, you know, helpful. Sorry, afterthought. So, here we go. My outline. Oh, wait, before I move on to that. I have heard it all from many skeptics. This is what I was saying. Many skeptics, many atheists, some of their biggest concerns have to do with the understanding of why there is evil in the world. Christians who falter in their faith. If you're, you know, if you're a believer in a supernatural God, why are you having a hard time walking and believing your faith? So what about all the sanctioned killings that are in Scripture throughout primarily the Old Testament? You know, almost genocides, and people have a hard time grasping why a God of love and compassion would do that. All of the religious diversity in the world, the hatred among the religious communities, and the warfare that oftentimes is because of religious differences, all of which are topics all for a different time. I'm not going to go into those. And then there comes this. The fantastical elements in the Bible, the ones that seem too far-fetched to believe, this brings us to the biblical testimony of Jesus. Not that it's too far-fetched for me to believe, or us, but there are a number of stories, and Michaela, my daughter, was saying, yeah, like, you know, what about that Jonah and the whale? Is that something I can believe? You know, all these Old Testament stories. What about walking on the water? Peter walked on the water. A lot of these stories, and I've had discussions with some of the guys I work with, and they say, I can't believe that. It's all, you know, it's all made up. It's kind of like Hollywood. If you want to believe all that, you know, that fake stuff, you know, more power to you. That's what they tell me. And so I try to do the best I can, be a witness, and to share the truth of the word. And that's all that God asks us to do. And I think to be honest with him, with the Lord, and with others. Don't try to fabricate. Don't try to come up with an answer for everything. Just because you don't have an answer doesn't mean there isn't one, and that, you know, oftentimes people want to try to trip us up in the discussion and just prove, oh, because you don't have an answer, you know, what you believe is false, and that proves I'm right. No, that's not the way it works. Well, here my outline is, and you have an outline. All of your sheets were supposed to have a blank spot in it, and that this outline would not be helpful. That was my point. So, first one, yes, Jesus really, what is it?
Existed.
Second one, Jesus was
more than
a man. And third one is, the scriptures are reliable. And number four, Jesus was truly resurrected. And I'm going to share in detail as much as I can on some of these to help us understand a little bit more and how to actually, you know, talk to people that have differing opinions on it. Is there evidence to support the Jesus that we find in the Bible? Did this Jesus really live? Now, some people feel that he didn't. So this is what they say, that he was not. No, but, okay, they say he was a mythical, made-up character in Scripture. And this cannot be further from the truth. I have proof. Yes, to both. There are as many as 39 extra biblical written sources in the first century, and a lot of research and archaeology is discovering more evidence. So as years go on and they find more things, not just extra biblical material, but they also find earlier manuscripts of the Bible, of the New Testament books, and that actually just verify the fact that we have a reliable source. And the earlier they go back into the first century, the better. And we realize that even first century manuscripts still say the same thing. Not like some of these skeptics say, oh, they have changed the words to fabricate and make Jesus fit into, okay, I have a slide about that later, but here we have some people, Josephus, well-known, first century, went around as a historian of Palestine area and documented a lot of information, and he is one of the primary resources that we have of religious histories in that area of the world. And then there's Clement of Rome, Ignatius, Pliny, the Talmud, and others that confirm this. Michaela tells me Pliny is one who died in the Mount Vesuvius eruption. It's like, oh, cool. There was Pliny the Older, Pliny the Younger, if you ever heard of them. But they also did writings of historical records. And yeah, like I said, there is a number of different documents out there that people can, you know, reference. They don't go into details. They just mention that this happened in this area or on this time, this day, or and so yes. In the words of Ignatius, I don't know if I want to go here yet. Hold on a minute. yes. Ignatius was directly taught by John. Let's read this first. In the words of Ignatius, he was condemned. He was crucified in reality and not in appearance, not in imagination, not in deceit. He really died and was buried and rose from the dead. Now, these are statements to debunk some other theories. And Ignatius lived in the first century. He was also a disciple of John, one of Jesus' disciples. And John was one of the oldest living of all of the apostles. Some feel that he lived right up to the end of the first century. So a lot of things that Ignatius is saying here are from eyewitness accounts. And people can feel that there are some proofs that we can accept from some of these early writings. Let's see, there were early statements of faith. All right, I already said that. Here we go on. There are early statements of faith in the first century that predate some of the obviously later century statements of creeds. Now, the Apostle Paul, in some of his writings, brought in some of those early statements of faith, especially in Corinthians. Let me see if I have that up here. Yes, and this is one of them. He was buried, and he rose again on the third day, according to the Scriptures. This was one of the things that oftentimes was a word-of-mouth statement of faith, that you had to believe that Jesus died, he was buried, and that he did rise again. And all of this was to fulfill prophecies in Scriptures. And this was one of the early first century statements that was shared around. And Paul went to document that as he was writing in 1 Corinthians. That was not original to Paul. That was something that had been circulating out there already in the first century. Which, you know, did they make it up? Did they, you know, hallucinate? All of this. How can somebody rise again after being dead 3 days? Well, obviously, they believed it. The first century Christians had high eyewitnesses. Let's go on to Paul and other early writers list firsthand witnesses to the Christ. Now, they talk about a number. Paul that lists, at one point, 500 or so, up to 500 people saw the risen Christ. Wow. And a lot of people I talk to say, yeah, but, you know, you're using references out of the Scripture. Yes, I am, because that's the most reliable that we have of these issues. Some of these witnesses date as early as 25 to 60 years after Jesus' crucifixion. What does that tell us? They were alive. Some of these witnesses were alive, and they shared, and they saw. Paul writes about the fact that they, and John even, that we saw him, we felt him. You know, we were there. We saw Jesus. And the fact that they talk about him in such a way, Jesus was unique. He was special. He was different. So yes, there is enough evidence, even without the Bible, to show that Jesus lived. Now, this is the thing I was going to get at here, is scholars are in agreement that it is these early reports these early reports were not fabricated in any way, that those who knew the truth would have spoken out in opposition if these testimonies were false or fabricated. Those who actually knew Jesus, if he wasn't who he said he was, if he didn't rise from the dead, if he didn't perform all these miracles, they would have debunked all those lies that were being propagated. But they weren't lies. The silence is proof that we can believe what is in the Scripture. All right, so, oh yeah, here we go. Joke 2, board meeting. Okay, I was sharing this in the car with my girls as well, and I had to explain it to them. Okay, here we go. There will be a meeting of the board immediately after the Christmas service, announced Reverend Morris. I had to explain what is a board. So after the close of the service, the group met at the back of the church for the announced meeting. However, this Christmas, there was a stranger in the midst, a visitor, who had never attended their church before. And then my friend asked Reverend Morris, "Did you understand that this is a meeting of the board?" And his reply is, "Oh, yes. After the sermon, I am as bored as you can get." I purposely put that slide up here because, you know, in case I am boring you. We will be having a meeting after the service to discuss that. Okay, anyway. I have another question that we are going to look at here. This is asking, so there is an historic Jesus, but was he truly what he claimed to be, who he claimed to be? Is he the unique Savior of the world? If so, he would have to be more than just an ordinary man, I would say, because, well, I can't do all these things that Jesus did. I don't know anyone else who can. It was only Jesus. So, Jesus was more than a man. And this is what I want to go into here. The uniqueness of Jesus' birth shows him to be the Son of God and Savior of the world. Some say that he could not be more than just a caring person, a prophet and preacher. Certainly not God, but there is reliable proof to the contrary. And I want to go into that a little bit. Certainly, we have messianic prophecies recorded in Psalm, Isaiah, Micah, and others to be considered that come to show that there was to be a Messiah come. That Messiah was to do things. That Messiah was, there are prophecies that Messiah was going to be killed and rise again. And there's prophecies as to where that Messiah was going to be born. There's a lot of information in the scriptures of the Old Testament that speak about it. And it's quite interesting that we have all of this going on. it was also prophesied that he would be born of a virgin and from the line of King David, which also happens. Micah 5:2, let's look at some of these. I put these in different order on my slide than I have on my sheets. Now, Micah, that's right, I started here because it speaks about his birth. So Christmas time is where we remember and worship, you know, the baby Jesus, and to, you know, reflect on the meaning of Jesus coming into the world. Here in Micah 5:2 says, "But you, O Bethlehem, Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days." Now Micah speaks that there was to be one sent, one to come. Quite interesting, because this happens hundreds of years prior to the birth of Jesus. And a lot of these Old Testament prophecies, oh, my guys at work say, "Well, that was written after Jesus." Oh, no. There's proof that it wasn't. Everybody's just reaching for straws, trying to, you know, save their face, whatnot. But yes, we have testimony here out of Micah. We have Isaiah 53. The entire 53 speaks about the Messiah. I just have a little bit. "Surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was a chastisement that brought us peace." And continuing, "And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Now this speaks about the Messiah and what the Messiah was to come and do, and the fact that it looks like he was pierced. Looks like he suffered for the sins of the world, and that God did this to the Messiah for us. It's quite interesting. And it kind of makes me think, wait a minute, there's another story in the Bible that seems pretty close to that. And, you know, obviously we draw upon the fact that Jesus fulfills that. And then also we move into Psalm. David writes this: "They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and they gloat over me, and they divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Another thing that really happened at the crucifixion. It's interesting that all these ancient, all these writings, passages, they undeniably fit the events surrounding the life of Jesus. You know, I could go on and on. There are over 100, 200, there's lots of prophecies that Jesus fulfills in the Old Testament. And, you know, John, Pastor John shared last week what the odds are of just one person fulfilling, of one person fulfilling what, they said eight? Well, it was astronomical. Was it one with like 17 zeros? And it's amazing. And Jesus fulfills way more than eight. And a lot of people feel, well, that's just because it's been fabricated. That's because they, you know, they rigged it so that, you know, you can... No, that didn't happen. And we have proof also of the... Well, I'm moving on to that. I'll talk about that. That the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered. And that dates to a time even way prior to Jesus. And these Dead Sea Scrolls verify the Old Testament that we have. A number of them. A number of these prophecies of the Messiah. And they were not changed after Jesus. Mary, Joseph, shepherds were visited by angels. Whoa, have you ever been visited by an angel? I've heard testimony that some people have seen an angel, or they thought they have. One of my friends at work would tell me, it's like, I said that, you know, I talked with the Lord this morning, and he was like, "Oh, you talked with the Lord." It's like, did he speak back? Did he talk back to you? And it's like, okay, because I kind of put my foot in my mouth there. I kind of asked for, in a way. And but it was a good conversation we had. You know, well, God speaks to me in the heart. God speaks to me out of the word. God speaks to me in, you know, many different ways. But I don't hear an audible voice. But his point was, in the Bible, it says God spoke with an audible voice. And if God's not speaking with audible voice, then he doesn't exist. That was his argument. Here we have, interesting, these angels, and there are others in the Bible. I can make an entire list of people who came across angels, who angels had given them warnings, angels, a number of things. People who bowed down to worship angels, and angels said, "Not, you know, don't do that." And you know, certainly we have some things in the New Testament around Jesus' birth that are unique, strange. There's no other religious leader, no other prophet that you could say some of these things about. Jesus fulfills over 100 Old Testament prophecies. That's actually a conservative number. The prophecies specifically about the Messiah, there's a whole lot of prophecies about Jesus and some of the things that happened in the New Testament, first century church, in the Old Testament prophecy. He performed miracles. Now, I don't know any other religious leader who performs a bunch of miracles in the way that Jesus did. In Acts 2:22, Luke records Peter's message to the people that they have seen and witnessed Jesus performing miracles among them and can attest to it that God has given him power and authority. It's interesting. Peter is preaching a sermon during Pentecost to all these people who were there, and a number of them were eyewitnesses of Jesus. There was a whole lot of people in town that were from out of town, and they heard all these firsthand witness stories, and they brought those stories back to their towns in different countries because they lived in different places. But it's amazing because Peter speaks that you are witnesses of this. You saw this happen. You can attest to it. It is not made up. So here, we certainly there is evidence to support that Jesus is unique among all the teachers, prophets, religious leaders who ever lived. And but can we believe what we read? Are the scriptures reliable? I wanted to say here that I missed this. No other religious leaders perform miracles. Not Buddha. Not Muhammad. And then again, I was sharing with Michaela, who's Buddha? Who's Muhammad? So I had to go into some, you know, information because there's a lot of people today who worship in those religions. And they did not perform miracles. They did not rise from the dead. In keeping with C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity, given all that Jesus had said and all that Jesus has done through reliable testimony, Luke records these, Paul records witnesses that had been there, and Paul himself saw the risen Lord. It would be possible to say that Jesus, or it would be impossible to say that Jesus was just a good, moral, upright teacher. And then to say, but he was not God. It's impossible. You can't do that. Later, I'm going to bring a little bit in, more into it, but that is where I got here. So now, number three, the scriptures are reliable. Now we're moving on to the last couple parts. Some would say the Bible is unreliable due to its being written in an archaic age where people did not understand the Bible they lived in. So I've been told that most of the people in the world of the Bible was... So long ago, people didn't have science like we have today. We understand more. We, you know, there's a lot that we can say is because of this and that. But back in those days, all they had was to go by faith. And they would make up things. Michaela was saying in her classes how Native Indians and other, you know, people groups around the world in history created a God for this, created a God for that. Because they didn't understand. And so they wanted to make an explanation. Same thing with the Greek gods and Roman gods, and so they came up with these stories to try and have an answer for the world that we live in. And all the stuff is all man-made from the wisdom of man, from our own folly. The scriptures come, and Paul shares with the leaders in Athens that the ignorance God now is demanding people, is requiring people to have the truth. And Paul is coming there to share. And the truth is that we have a Savior who has come in the world, and that we must learn about Him, follow Him. So it has lost this. They also say that the Scripture has lost its authenticity due to multiple translations. I've heard someone tell me this. Well, the Bible's been written, rewritten, and over, written again so many different times, nobody can believe anything in it anymore. It's kind of like textbooks. Which revision edition is it? It's been revised. It's been changed. No, it's not really like that. If there's changes, it's more accurate now. Much of the content is frankly unbelievable fantasy, simply made up nonsense. I've said that. It's not the case. Continual discovery of original Greek manuscripts prove authentic and reliable. The truth is that current archaeology and history give credence to the scripture's reliability, given that more than 5,000 original Greek manuscripts from before 1500 AD, and again, that's actually a conservative number because that is referring to more complete documents. It's closer to 20,000 if you add all of the partial pieces of these New Testament books. And they have been recovered and proven authentic. A good number are from the third centuries. Surprisingly, these earliest copies show very little variance, as has occurred over time. And many ancient Hebrew writings have been recovered, including the Dead Sea Scrolls, which date to a time before Christ and remained undisturbed since. All this serves to verify the accuracy of the Old Testament and the New Testament in our Bibles today. When somebody tells me that, the Bible, you can't believe the Bible, well, I can read the Bible and I can know that it's very close to what the author intended for it to say. And, whether the author was inspired by God or not, I oftentimes tell people, how come there is a connection from something written 1,000 years earlier to right here? And, there's all these connections throughout Scripture. I believe that it's because the Scripture was inspired by God. And there are authors in the Bible that wrote about things that they were not even there. They didn't see. And we can believe and trust that God, being inspiring them, wrote the truth, gave them the truth to write about of these events. Quite interesting. According to Norman Geisler's research, there is evidence that the first writings of Luke was completed about 30 years after the death of Jesus. Some of the early thoughts about that. And also, it is possible that Mark's gospel was already circulating by then too. And only a couple years later, Paul now is writing his epistles. This is, early stuff. These aren't just, written like a generation later, 100 years later. No, this was written in the contemporary time that these events were happening. New studies, and that's just shared right here. All this stuff is what I've just been talking about. New studies are supporting a much earlier dating to the original writings than previously thought. That helps us to understand, and not just understand, but to trust what we read in the Scripture as being reliable. Norman Geisler's research, he has spent a lot of time studying kind of like the uniqueness of Jesus, the uniqueness of the Christ. He has studied the reliability of the New Testament authors, focusing on Luke and Paul and some of the earliest of these. And He says here, like I shared, about 30 years after the death of Jesus, it is also possible that Mark's gospel, you know, and certainly this is significant in that it leaves no room for the skeptics to theorize about the events being fabricated or exaggerated. This is some of the things that a lot of people say. Well, there was embellishments in Scripture. There were, you know, they say, well, it's obviously fake. It's like, is it? It's like, prove it to me that it's obviously fake. Well, they can't. Their proof is, well, I can't do that. Got to be fake. I've never seen that happen. Got to be fake. No, that's not good enough for me. So the closer the writings are to the actual events, the better. And no, the Bible has not been rewritten numerous times as to embellish the stories to fit a certain agenda, like to make Jesus fit into the prophecies. They tell me that as well. You know, the only way that Jesus could have been, you know, fulfillment of those prophecies is if those prophecies were rewritten in some way, or that Jesus' life was rewritten in some way to make him fit. And again, they say, well, that's the reason they believe that Jesus never existed. It'd be easy for someone to write a fictitious character to fit the prophecies of something. But we know, we've already gone over, Jesus really existed. And these testimonies of firsthand witnesses, if they were false, they would have spoke up against it. This is true material. The study of these ancient texts proves this to not be the case. Painstaking accuracy has been taken by many New Testament authors in their reporting of these events. And speaking of Luke, Luke says, inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as these who from the beginning were eyewitnesses. And Paul starts this, or Luke says his gospel this way. And ministers of the word have delivered them to us. It seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. This is the reason that Luke is writing his gospel, and then later Acts, Gospel Acts, penned by Luke. And a lot of theologians believe, by scrutinizing Luke's writings, that he is one of the time period, one of the most recognized historians to be believed. He painstakingly researched and interviewed and looked through all that was out there and wanted to bring it together and bring it as clear and truthful as possible. Jesus was truly resurrected. The skeptics say this never happened, that the witnesses hallucinated. Jesus did not die when they removed him from the cross. These are theories. His body was stolen. That's interesting. Is that all you have? Because there, all of these are just easy to be, debunked, really. There's all kinds of talk about this made-up story of Jesus' resurrection. So I've been told by guys, it's made up. You know, it can't be made up. In fact, it's a central tenet of Christian doctrine. Paul talks about if Jesus was not resurrected, what are we doing here? More than 500 people witnessed the risen Lord Jesus, we are told. Proof, nearly 1,000 years. Now, I'm actually moving ahead kind of quickly through some of this material at this point. Where am I at? I want to make sure that I'm tracking the right spot here. David writes about the resurrection of the Messiah. Psalm 16:10. I didn't have this earlier in the other area where I was doing the prophecies. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. A lot of scholars feel that this is referring to the Messiah. And there's other passages in Psalms 2 and even around this verse that speak about the Messiah. And here, specifically, because I'm talking about the resurrection, that the Messiah was to be resurrected. The Messiah was not to be dead and buried and in the grave and done and gone. the prophecies in the Old Testament are clear that the Messiah was to rule forever. And so David is writing this here. Jesus claimed to be this Messiah and that he too would be resurrected. Okay. Now, anyone who, you know, if you come across someone on the street and they believe, you know, that they can fly or that, you know, they can, you know, whatnot, talk to animals. There's movies about that. Yeah, I don't know if I would really believe everything that they're saying. That was some of the theories, that maybe Jesus is crazy. Okay, well, what happens with all those witnesses? Were they crazy as well? Matthew says, and Jesus was going up to Jerusalem. He took the 12 disciples aside, and on the way, he said to them, see that we are going up to Jerusalem to the Son, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and he will be raised on the third day. Do we often talk about ourselves in the third person? Jesus is speaking to his disciples about the Messiah, about the Son of Man, and they already knew. He's speaking about himself. And Jesus is speaking about him in the third person because Jesus this has been prophesied. This is going to happen. And Jesus was coming to a realization on his own humanity that this is going to happen. And this is my purpose for being here. And Jesus was sharing that with the apostles as they were on their journey. John speaks about this as well. He says, for this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Jesus here is saying that he has authority over his life, over his death, when that's going to occur, and the fact that he can rise back up from that. Interesting. I don't know anyone else, any other religious prophet, any other leader that actually did what he said in this. If they did say this, certainly it would be a statement a little far-fetched. But when they saw that Jesus did rise, they started to believe in more detail of the truth of what he had been saying. All of Christianity depends on the resurrection having occurred. In fact, it is the proof that Jesus was all that he claimed to be. You know, if Jesus went out and he preached and he said all these words and he, you know, made these statements, if he had not risen from the dead, maybe people would not have accepted as much of his teachings. But that solidifies that Jesus was who he was. I don't believe that the Christian faith would have ever taken off without the first century assurance that the resurrection really occurred. It is too much a fundamental, you know, center of the Christian faith. That's the way I feel about it. Certainly, Jesus was and is unique in so many more ways than we can even grasp. I mean, you know, was it Luke? One of the gospel writers said, there is no library that can contain John, all that could be written about this man, Jesus. It's just, you know, amazing. Jesus was truly unique in history. No one else ever, before or after, in the future, would even compare to what Jesus has said, what he has done. Today we acknowledge he is God and Savior, having come to earth meek and in the form of a baby born in Bethlehem. We worship that. We worship Jesus, but we remember the Christmas story. And I was telling Michaela during our song today about the kings from the east. I said to Michaela, they were not at the manger. They had to travel for months. Anyway, so Anyway, so there's a lot of, you know, songs. And again, guys at work will tell me, it's like, you know, why do you worship Jesus on Christmas? Jesus wasn't born on Christmas Day. And how come all of these religious holidays are in pagan holidays? You know, well, they know, but, you know, we've talked about that at work. But, sure, that is true. You know, all this stuff. But, yeah, we worship. We worship the Lord. We acknowledge who he is and the uniqueness of God coming into the world to save us from our sins so that we can have fellowship, so we can actually be what we were created to be. So in closing, yes, Jesus really existed. Now, I talk to guys at work, you know, it's like, you know, it's kind of hard to not accept that. He was more than a man. The scriptures are reliable, and Jesus was truly resurrected. Who was it that said, we only have a few choices. Jesus was either a liar, a lunatic, or he was Lord. And, you know, I believe he was Lord. And what are we going to do? Yeah, they were martyred, right, for their beliefs.
For their beliefs. And you know, it's a lie.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
the Apostle John was, would they be willing to die for a lie? They're not just were the apostles, but a lot of first century, during the persecution of some of the emperors, Nero, for one. There's another one that was later. But, yeah, many Christians in the world were martyred for their faith. And, you know, throughout history, there has also never been anyone as prolific or outgoing for writing as much, doing as much as the Apostle Paul in the New Testament. A lot of things I read about that said that that the Apostle Paul was so active, so much out there. You know, he was he was not afraid to go out and talk with people and to, he would spend weeks, he would spend months, he would spend years in places teaching and helping them understand who this Jesus was and what it means for you and why you should accept him. And it's quite interesting. You know, we have missionaries today going around. Apostle Paul was, a missionary. But each of us are called by the Lord in our own little areas of the world to be a missionary, to share the truth of the gospel, to share our understanding of who Jesus was. And I want us to, to take from this a little bit more confident in the scriptures that we have, a little more confidence in the uniqueness that Jesus is. And certainly, if people have any, any doubts, I want us to, you know, there are a lot of people that have done studies to help us understand the truth that is out there. So let's, are we going to have a song? Okay. Well, that's all I have right now.